Thank you very much. Welcome. Welcome to Perimeter Institute's public lecture series presented by BMO Financial Group. My name is Greg Dick. I'm the Director of Educational Outreach here at Perimeter, and it is a pleasure to welcome everyone here this evening. For those of you watching online, we have Dr. Damian Pope and a team of PI researchers behind their keyboards at the ready following the Twitter and the Facebook feeds to engage in discussion throughout the lecture, and we'll be there as well after to continue the conversation if you have questions. And now, it's my opportunity to introduce our very special guest speaker. Dr. Mike Cates is the 19th Lucasian Professor of Mathematics at the University of Cambridge. That's a chair that was previously held by Stephen Hawking, Paul Dirac, and Isaac Newton. Dr. Cates received his PhD in theoretical physics in 1985. A decade later, he moved to Scotland to take up the chair of natural philosophy at the University of Edinburgh, a position he held for over 20 years. He was elected a fellow to the Royal Society in 2007 and has since received numerous awards, including the Dirac Medal from the Institute of Physics and the Bingham Medal of the U.S. Society of Rheology. Dr. Cates is renowned for his work in soft condensed matter and for the creation of statistical mechanical models, particularly in the relation to flow behavior. Tonight, Dr. Cates will share his research and share a demonstration in his lecture called Bulletproof Custard, Fluids That Stop Flowing When You Push Them Too Hard. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Dr. Michael Cates.
Thank you, Greg. Thank you. Where are my slides? Here we go. Okay. Well, it's a great pleasure to be here. So I'm going to, as we've just heard, talk about bulletproof custard, and I'll say what I mean by that during the course of the talk. But first I'm going to have a slightly more general introduction to the field of soft matter physics, something which you'll all be familiar with in everyday terms, but not necessarily as a branch of physics. And we'll then specialize on the particular type of system that I'll be talking about, of which there is quite a large sample over there, which I hope to show you more of later, which is a dense suspension of hard particles in a solution, in this case, in water. In particular, the class of dense suspensions that I want to describe are shear thickening suspensions. I'll say what that is. What I'll do is I'll outlay the spectrum of phenomena that a theoretical model should try to explain, and tell you what our most recent thoughts on such a model are. I should say the model we have has a mathematical structure, but mostly it can be explained using quite simple sketches of various kinds of things called flow curves. So I shall try to focus on this kind of graphical mathematics element rather than dazzle you with the full glory of the theory. And at the end, I hope to have a little time to say why this might be useful in various technology contexts. But first, I want to acknowledge my co-authors, well, co-workers on this field, from the University of Durham, Edinburgh, where I was until last year, Romain Mari, who's a postdoc in Edinburgh now, and particularly Mathieu Viard, on the right-hand side here, who's now at Lausanne. And the main theoretical model and the progress I'll be describing is actually the work that he and I did together in 2014. So, soft matter. So if you look up soft matter on Wikipedia, you'll find a list of types of material that are soft matter. Polymers, micelles, suspensions, emulsions, foams, liquid crystals, and this may or may not mean much to you, but in fact, these are things that we encounter daily. So an example of a polymer solution is an engine oil, so that consists of long polymer chains in a short molecular solvent. Micellar systems, which are also polymer-like structures made out of soap molecules, are in nearly all brands of shampoo. and suspensions, or toothpaste suspension, etc. I can go on down this list. So you can see why these are called soft matter. They're mostly pretty soft. But there's also a whole branch of physics connected with the kind of high-tech end of soft matter. So all polymers, all plastics, rather, in processing are go through a molten stage or a semi-solid stage. Additives very similar to what you have in shampoo are used in things like this oil pipeline down here. Pharmaceuticals, drug delivery, etc. Foams, foams get used in cleaning up after fires and things like that. And liquid crystals are in every single one of your laptops and mobile phones. So the picture as physicists we can have of these systems is to back off from the molecular detail of exactly what's in there and try to classify them into broad categories. And then within each category, we're hoping to find universal types of behavior, which does include the phenomena I'll show you later in this jar here. So polymers we think of as molecular spaghetti. Suspensions of colloidal suspensions, or these kind of dense suspensions here, are basically molecular ping pong balls or microscopic ping pong balls, small hard particles suspended in a solvent such as water. Liquid crystals are also like that, but then you have to think of them as needle-shaped structures here. So today I'll focus on the middle one. Suspensions, the baseline model, molecular ping pong balls, and how does the presence of this structure, the fact that I have some kind of organization of these solid particles inside my suspension, how does that control its macroscopic behavior? And in particular, how does it control the flow behavior, which, as we should see, can at times be spectacular? So one of the main intriguing features of the flow behavior that we'll see is the presence of an effect like a traffic jam. It's a jamming phenomenon. And so what I want to do next is show you some other natural phenomena involving jamming and unjamming. So the top right is fairly familiar. Bottom left is actually a log jam, literally. You're in Canada, so you should know all about that, but most Europeans have never seen or heard of a real log jam. This is a landslide. And as you can see, this is something which was solid, but is now turned into a fluid. And obviously, if that happens near you, you need to get out of the way. This is only an animation, because this kind of thing, when it happens, you're rarely waiting for it with a camera crew. This is a grain silo. And this is it's something you really don't want to happen in your grain silo. It's to do with the buildup of stresses in a granular packing, quite similar, in fact, to the kind of thing I'll be talking about later on. And then a catastrophic unjamming in that final frame, as you saw. So, on to the main deal, dense suspensions under flow. So, let me show you a couple of movies. And let's get them both running at once. Okay, so on the left here, this is looks like a computer simulation, but it's actually an experiment. So what's done here is you have these microscopic colloidal ping pong balls, roughly 1 micron particles in a solvent, and you're shearing them. So you have a moving plate across the top here, which is moving to the right, and a stationary plate at the bottom. You saw here a similar movie, this time a computer simulation in two dimensions. Show that one again. So you can see here this also, so the blue arrows here are showing you the average velocity. So you have this shear effect. But you can see this has a kind of stop-start motion to it. So the fact that this is an unsteady flow is all part of this jamming phenomenon that you get in dense suspensions. So the presence of this kind of behavior is actually quite mysterious, at least in terms of the standard way of thinking about these systems. And that the fact that it's the models we had until recently anyway, were quite constrained as to what they could predict, and they could not predict some of the phenomena that I shall be showing you. So let's go to the baseline model of fluid flow, which is Newton's law of viscosity, so you can read about this in Latin, in Principia. So we have a stress. So if I have a moving plate and a stationary plate, I have a stress force per unit area horizontally on the top plate here. The displacement is rdt. So r is the strain rate, so that's the speed of this plate divided by the depth of the sample. and the area of the top plate is A. So Newton said, okay, the force is proportional to the rate of strain, in other words, proportional to the amount of shearing you're putting in. So S equals nu times R, nu, Greek letter nu. If you want to read that as V for viscosity, that's fine too. In the field, stress is usually called sigma, strain rate is usually called gamma dot. I'm trying to be a bit more sensible than that. So stress as a function of rate, strain rate, R. Newton's law says that stress is proportional to strain rate. So the viscosity is the slope of these lines here, and it varies from fluid to fluid, but in each case you have a straight line. So that is a class of behavior which is widely seen and is called Newtonian flow behavior. However, other things are also seen. So non-Newtonian fluids have a stress as a function of rate, which is not a straight line, and can have all kinds of curvature and variation, various names, shear thinning, shear thickening. As you can imagine, those describe the case where the stress is curving downwards or curving upwards. And the case I'll be talking about is extreme or discontinuous shear thickening. So there are many examples of these. The ones on the left, water, olive oil, honey, molten glass, these are Newtonian. You might not think that about melted glass, but it is. And it's extremely viscous, but Newtonian. Honey there, I mean the kind of runny kind, maple syrup, better example. These ones on the right, including saliva, the engine oil I talked about before, putty, molten plastic, these are non-Newtonian. These all have non-linearity in those curves. And the mystery is why the molecular ping-pong balls, the dense suspension, why is it ever non-Newtonian? Because the first-pass theory seems to constrain it in such a way that it must be Newtonian. So that's part of the story I shall try to tell you. So, it looks like I'm getting through this talk very quickly, doesn't it? Fortunately, I'm going to focus on how we explain it. So, shear thickening suspensions. Okay, so first, though, I want to gather the phenomena. I want to tell you what it is that a theory should try to explain. Shear thickening suspensions are liquids that solidify at large stresses, hence the title. Ubleck, if you go to your popular science web pages and many science fairs and all kinds of events and school lecture talks, which I give myself, Ubleck has become the word for this material. This is cornstarch in water here. I'm just about to show you what it does. And based apparently on this remarkable book by Dr. Seuss. So, in which the world is apparently invaded by a non-Newtonian fluid. I've not read this book, I'm afraid. I'm sure many of you have, but it's a sort of sounds a rather surreal nightmare. Anyway, let me show you some. So what we have here is cornstarch suspension. So you can go buy cornstarch, and custard powder is the same as cornstarch. It just has yellow dye in it and some sugar. Hence, bulletproof custard. I could have said bulletproof cornstarch, but that would even an even weirder title. So I'm going to drop this stick in here. So the idea is that this is a fluid if I'm very gentle. So I'm barely touching this, and I can move the stick around, and you can see I can wobble it, and it looks pretty runny, maybe a bit sticky. But then, a bit difficult getting the stick out. Let's try this. Okay, so this is an unusual fluid. I've actually smashed the beaker here, and it's not leaking out. But this now you can also see it's gone in. Okay, so it's doing what I said in the title. If you're gentle with this, it's quite runny. If you're violent with it, it just resists. So as somebody who recently, for the first time, became the owner of a dog. Dog owners will know what it's like to have a dog that has a different view of where you're going on your walk from you. It doesn't matter. The harder you pull it, the slower it goes. So this is really the same. So let's be gentle. I'll try to be gentle with this first. But even now, you see. That's good. So let's leave that like this, see what happens. So this may fall off at some point. having already broken the beaker, I shouldn't complain too much. So you see, there's lots of very interesting flow instabilities here. So what's happening then is that the fact that this is harder to flow when you push it hard has a bunch of phenomena associated with it. One is that the transition from being easy to flow to being hard to flow can be very sudden, and the other is that the resulting flow can be very unstable. And if you see how wobbly the front of this kind of sheet of cornstarch is here, this is not like the flow of any Newtonian fluid. Even if I slow down the movie, you just don't get this kind of instability. So let me see if this will stay without falling off. I'll try and leave that a little bit longer. It's going to fall off eventually. Right. How are we doing? Oh, what's that? Oh, I see. Yeah, well, I want to go back to my slides now. Oh, thank you. Yeah, so you can place your bets as to when that's going to fall off during my talk and scatter bits of wet gloop all over the place. Okay, so this is the Daily Mail, one of the UK's most reputable newspapers, talking a few years back about bulletproof custard. So how it works, you can read how it works. Traditional bulletproof vest is made of laminated Kevlar, and Norman Wagner in University of Delaware has got patents, and the US Army is developing bulletproof clothing, which has much less Kevlar, and between each layer of Kevlar and the next is a layer of stuff very like this. So the idea then is that the bullet is like the hammer. It hits it and it solidifies, and that spreads the load out of a much wider area, so you can get away with much less Kevlar and much less damage when you're shot. So bulletproof custard is their phrase, but I was very happy to borrow it. And of course, this isn't custard, but it is exactly what you get with custard powder if you put much too much powder into the water. You'll also see things like this online, which is the same. This, you need a lot of cornstarch, but it's quite fun if you can get it. And yes, there is sound on this movie. That's good, isn't it? There's sound on this movie, but I don't know what expletives that guy is uttering in his own language. So it's quite lucky that it is muted, in fact. And let's just see that again. So the first guy, you can see the whole movie, including this guy falling, you know, sinking in, which is just like the hammer did. He just stood still for a while and sank. And if you don't stand still, you can run across the top. See, that's still going over there. So this is the, and this is now, look at the logarithmic axes here. This is the stress as a function of strain rate for a shear thickening suspension, of which this is an example, although that's not exactly the one in the picture here. And you can see that at a certain rate of strain, or above a certain stress, about 10 pascals, certain rate of strain, there's two orders of magnitude jump in the stress. So a huge leap in viscosity. And what's more, there's hysteresis. In other words, you go up on the right-hand red arrow here. And then if you back off, so slow things down again, you come at a slightly higher stress and come back down a different curve. So that's a signature of certain kinds of physics that I will indicate in a minute, hysteresis. And if you look more closely at data like this, so this is actually data from this year from the group in Edinburgh that I'm still associated with and used to be in. So these are a bunch of flow curves, again, stress against rate of strain on logarithmic axes. And what you're doing here to go from one curve to the other is you're changing the concentration. And this actually is cornstarch. It's just like that. So that stuff there is probably about where the blue curve is. So there's a parameter, which is the concentration. So the dimensionless measure of concentration is actually the volume occupied by the solid particles, the fraction of the volume of space in this solution that's occupied by solid. So number per unit volume times 4/3 pi r cubed if they're spherical, which, of course, cornstarch is not exactly spherical, but we know how to correct for that. So this is a dimensionless number. It's important that it's dimensionless. But it's the control parameter which takes you from one flow curve to another. What you also find, though, when you look at this more closely, is that in these very vertical curves here, like the blue one, the flow is not... There you go. Now, I actually am going to... OK. So now I'm afraid I have to issue advice to the cleaners, and I'm sorry about this. There's puddles of this all over the carpet, but you just have to wait for it to completely dry, and then you vacuum it up. I'm sorry. I wasn't planning that quite that way. Okay. So, the flow has structure. It's not steady. So, for instance, if I take somewhere in the middle of this, if I take a sample like that one and I put it in a professional flow measuring device, which is called a rheometer, so I have a carefully designed machine with moving parts that I can measure the stress as a function of time, I get a curve like the thing on the left. So an ordinary Newtonian fluid, that would just be flatlining in time. It obviously has a stress that is proportional to the rate, but if the rate's held constant, the stress is not wobbling around like that. So that's another characteristic feature, and it's also what we saw, or related to this phenomenon here. So to say a little bit more about the movie, the red bars here are showing you the connections between particles and the forces that are carried between them. So in a computer simulation, you can figure all that out. You can't measure it directly in an experiment. But you see what you have there is a network of forces which is coming and going, and you slow up and speed down according as to how well connected is the structure. So that brings me to the explanation of what's going on. My computer says 1 hour, 36 minutes, and 10 seconds have elapsed since the start of the talk. So this is a disadvantage of having it set up too far ahead. I shall switch to my watch. Right. So how do we explain this? Well, there is a phenomenological behavior in terms of the stress as a function of rate of strain, which, if only we could explain that, would explain this. So let me say what I mean. Here is a viscous fluid. These are called the flow curve. S of R is a flow curve, and for a Newtonian fluid, it's a straight line. And I'm just increasing the concentration. If, as a function of concentration, I could get the following evolution of my flow curves, then everything you've seen would be explained. And this is increasing concentration here. If I could get the flow curves only to do this, then everything would be fine. And the reason is that these decreasing parts of the flow curve are mechanically unstable. So when you enter this kind of region of parameter space of stress or strain rate, you expect flow instabilities. And you also expect sudden stress jumps for this reason. Oh, so let me do the instabilities first. So the dotted part of the curve here is unstable just for the same reason as a particle at the top of a potential is unstable. This will just split off to either one side or the other if I work at fixed rate of strain here. And you can think about the acceleration of a small piece of fluid in a regime where the stress is decreasing with strain rate. You can see that it's got a positive feedback and will run away in one direction or another. So the flow instabilities one can understand from the negative slope regions of these flow curves. And the hysteresis, likewise, if I gradually increase my stress, or rather, if I increase the rate of strain here, then at some point I can't go any further on this lower part of the curve, and this is all unstable, so I end up jumping discontinuously to the upper branch here. And again, these can be two orders or three orders of magnitude apart in stress. And then if I come down, I can experience a hysteresis loop, which comes down to this back kink here. So that's all fine. In other words, we know exactly what the target is for our theory. It's flow curves which look like that one, or particularly the whole family that I described before. So let me explain why that poses a difficulty. So here's what we want to explain. Flow curves of this type, let's just take a typical one out of the middle. So all we need is a flow curve with a wiggle. Now, however, if there's going to be a wiggle, and I'm going to have a theory of it, I have to be able to tell you where the wiggle is. So if we think about dimensions, mass per unit length time to minus 2, so mass, length, and time enter the stress. The stress has the same dimensions as pressure. The strain rate is the rate of change of an angle, essentially. So that's got dimensions of 1 over time. So I have to somehow find some physics that fixes one of these parameters. And the problem is that if we turn to our standard model of dense suspensions, which is this microscopic ping pong ball model, it turns out I can't do that. So let me just explain what the problem is in those terms. The solvent has a viscosity. So that has dimensions that we know. It's one factor of time times the dimensions of the stress. We know, however, as those of you familiar with fluid flow of any kind will understand from what I've been showing over there, that inertia isn't relevant at the microscopic scale here. In other words, the fact that these particles have mass is not important. The fluid has mass, the particle density and the fluid density almost the same. This is not to do with accelerations. The whole of the flow of these dense suspensions is to do with the fact that particles are slowly pushing fluid around. It's all overdamped in that sense. So there isn't a mass coming from the particles either. They do have a size, call that big R, and they have some force between them, which in the standard model is basically a hardcore interaction. So the force is zero until the particles touch, and then it goes straight to infinity. So that's the kind of simplification that theoretical physicists like to make. And in this field of suspension physics, that has got us a very long way. So 50 years of progress are based on that sort of model. But in this particular context, we have a problem, Houston. If I look at this, I can get a length from the particle size, but I cannot get a time. And I look at that force curve, again, length from the fact that it sets in at 2r, but it's either zero or infinity. So there's no scale connected with that either. So what I can't do is find a time scale which I would need to convert the solvent viscosity into a characteristic stress, S star. So I cannot, from this physics, I cannot make a characteristic stress or a characteristic strain rate, because that, again, requires is the inverse of a time. So from the particle size, the fact that they're hardcore interactions, and the fact that they're in a solvent of viscosity nu s, cannot give me a wiggle, because there's no physics there, dimensionally, that can present a characteristic value of stress or strain rate to me. So that's a kind of slightly subtle argument, and it sounds like there must be a loophole. Well, of course, there is a loophole, otherwise I wouldn't be able to go on with the talk, but it's a subtle loophole. So the question is, which of those assumptions has to go, essentially? And something will have to. But meanwhile, let's just recap that. Standard model, then, we have a system where if I have strictly hard particles in a solvent, then depending on the concentration of those particles, I can have a low viscosity at low concentration or a very high viscosity at higher concentration. Or, in fact, if I push the concentration too high, the viscosity can diverge, and then I have a solid. But nonetheless, what I have in the standard model is either a perfectly Newtonian curve with a certain slope, or in the case where that slope is infinite, I have a solid. What I can't have is a wiggle or anything which jumps discontinuously from flowable to jammed behavior. It's either always flowable or it's always jammed. So that doesn't explain any of the phenomena I showed you. So nu is the viscosity of the suspension as a function of concentration, and it has the potential to diverge at a characteristic concentration, which is a key parameter and is something that holds in it the explanation to everything I have shown you. So this parameter, this is called the jamming concentration for obvious reasons. So below CJ you can flow, above CJ you cannot flow. And an interesting question is what controls that concentration, and this is something which we've only very recently understood, and I think the entire community is a bit embarrassed by the fact that it took so long to understand what was happening here. But what you find is that the position of this divergence here, so the place where the viscosity goes infinite, where this curve goes vertical, depends on the nature of the friction between these hard ping pong balls. And I never mentioned friction up to now. So that's the new piece of physics, but it enters in a specific way that I want to now explain. So essentially this was kind of realized in a strange holographic way by a whole load of people at roughly the same time, about 3 or 4 years ago. So why does friction matter here? And why is the nature of the interaction, the contact friction interaction between particles, what's needed to understand these sudden changes of behavior? Okay, so let me say a bit about that. The dense suspension, as I showed from the movie, you have some kind of network which flickers in and out of existence of load-bearing contacts between these particles. And this is connected with a problem studied in the Victorian age, which is how many struts do you need to make a building not fall down? So that's the Forth Road Bridge, which is close to my heart, having lived in Edinburgh for 20 years, under construction sometime in mid-Victorian age. So this, for whatever reason, I don't actually know why he was interested in it, this occupied James Clerk Maxwell in one of his idler moments when he wasn't solving electromagnetism and thermodynamics and most other physics of the day. So he asked, how many connections do you need for a rigid structure? And he immediately realized that this depends on the type of connection. In particular, if I have a fixed joint between two struts in my bridge, then I have a constraint of the length and the angle between each pair, each node, if you like, all the angle, and so a fixed joint constrains angles as well as separations between the nodes. A hinged joint constrains only the lengths. And so a square is rigid if these are fixed, but if they are hinged, it is not rigid. A triangle is rigid either way. So translating essentially the identical conceptual physics into the problem of our dense colloidal suspension, we are drawn to the following question. What we have in a packing like this is we have a certain number of contacts per particle, and these contacts, the number of contacts per particle is strongly dependent on the density of the packing, hence on the concentration of particles. So I'm just, although it depends also on other things, I'm going to suppose that this is just a function of concentration. So in these, if I got my microscopic ping pong balls, they're touching, and some of them have friction, but some of them are sliding. So I can distinguish between a contact which in which it's obliged by friction to roll. If I get the same two particles and I separate them a little bit, then they may be able to slide. So that question of separation will come back in a minute. But let's suppose just for now that I have a certain fraction of rolling contacts and the others are sliding. So there's this criterion, which I'll explain on the next slide, which says that when the number of contacts per particle is bigger, and this is in three dimensions, than 4f plus 6 times 1 minus f, and a different result in two dimensions, then this is rigid. So if I have sliding particles, I need 6 contacts per particle. If I have rolling particles, I only need 4. So what that means is there's a range of densities where the number of contacts per particle is in the middle here somewhere, where it's crucial as to whether they're frictional or whether they're rolling or whether they're sliding. And it's that transition which actually can control unusual behavior of these very dense shear thickening suspensions. So let's just develop that a little bit more. So this is where the real theory is, other than just the curve sketching. This is to do with counting equations, not solving them. This is all Maxwell did, so we'll do the same here. N spheres, three dimensions, and I'm going to ask about the total number of forces, torques, equations, contacts, variables, and whether the packing is rigid. So let's just quickly go through this. So if the in three dimensions, if the so what I have is at each contact, let me see if I'm going to get this right. Yeah, so this is not a contact. So I have n particles. So I have to specify the force on each of those particles, and the force is a vector. So I have 3n forces that need to be in balance. They would need to vanish on each particle for the system not to be moving. That's true whether the contacts are sliding or rolling. If I have rolling particles, I also have to balance the torques on a particle. So there are tangential forces at the surfaces, and they also have to sum to zero. So I have that many torques, which also have to sum to zero. If they're sliding, I don't have to worry about torques at all, because all the forces between particles are normal to the interparticle separation. So the talks drop out here. So this is the number of equations, if you like, the number of quantities that have to equal zero. I can also ask how many contacts I've got. That's the same in both cases. It's z times n over 2. So each particle has z contacts, z, if we're in North America, excuse me. And they're shared by two particles. So zn over 2. And the number of variables, at each contact, I have this number of variables for the forces between particles. It's just one per shared contact if it's a normal force because it's a sliding system. If it's rolling, I have to specify both tangential components of the force as well. So the criterion for rigidity is possibly slightly unintuitive. It's when the number of variables is bigger than the number of equations. And that's actually kind of sounds like the opposite of what you'd think about when you can solve an equation. But the reason for this is a system is rigid if there are many static solutions to the equations of force balance. So if there's a multiplicity of static solutions, then the system cannot flow because I can vary the forces and the thing stays static. If this is underdetermined, then it's essentially flowable. So if you just take a weighted sum of rolling contacts and sliding contacts, you get the criterion that I gave you on the previous slide. Okay, so and that's as technical as this talk is going to get. So the rest of it is graphical mathematics based on this. So what I can do is I can, by computer simulation or measurement or whatever, I can figure out what is the state of coordination of a packing as a function of its concentration. And what I find then is that if all the contacts in my network are rolling, so a maximum friction situation, then the critical density at which the Newtonian viscosity diverges, well, there's the transition between a liquid phase and a solid here, is at about 58% volume fraction. If they're all sliding, it's at about 64%. So these numbers are different, and it means that as you approach this region, it becomes physically crucial to the behavior of the system whether the contacts are frictional or not. So you might think, oh, well, he's done it now. It's friction. But the other thing to notice is that friction is described by a friction coefficient, which is also dimensionless. It's telling me the maximum tangential to normal force. So if I just say there's friction, I have not yet given myself a piece of physics which allows me to set a characteristic scale of either stress or rate of strain that places the wiggle. So I need a little bit more physics than this. So let me just summarize then what we have from the standard model allowing for friction. So this is molecular ping pong balls with friction. I still have either a Newtonian fluid or a jammed solid. But the place in the, as I increase the concentration, the place where I jam up is lower for frictional contacts than for sliding contacts. Right. So to remind you what we're after, we still want, instead of a family of curves like this, all straight lines, we still want this family of curves. So, but having laid all that groundwork, it's actually, it's all downhill from here as to how we can get this family of curves. What we need to do is we need to admit that the standard model, molecular ping pong balls, is slightly deficient, which is not the first time you'll have heard about that for a standard model. So, and then you have to think a bit about what is the key piece of physics that's not in the model that I've described so far, even allowing for friction between contacts, and to the ansatz, if you like, that lets the facts fall into place is this one. All we need to do is say, okay, these particles are not quite hard sphere repulsive. As they approach, before coming right into contact, they experience a repulsion. So there's many ways in which that happens. In cornstarch, it's because they have a slight electrostatic charge, which has a very short screening length, but it still has a finite liftoff from zero up here. So as soon as you accept that, then you can immediately you have a characteristic force, which is the force I need to push two of these particles against this extra repulsion to actually get them into contact. And the point is that until they're actually in contact, they can always slide, right? So effectively, the friction only switches on when you exceed this scale of force, F star, at the particle level. So that gives us a stress scale. And in dimensional terms, it's easy to construct that. It's this characteristic force divided by the radius squared. And the idea then is if I'm in a situation where the stress, the macroscopic stress in my system is below this value, there's nothing forcing the particles into intimate contact, and most of the contacts are sliding, so mostly frictionless contacts. If the stress exceeds that value, I've really got things pushed into close proximity, and friction is switched on. So there's no doubt, though, that if you accept that picture, this progression from mostly frictionless to mostly frictional contacts as a function of stress here is going to be smooth, right? So what I'm asking you to accept now is that there's a smooth transition from frictionless to frictional contacts as a function of stress. So that means that the dimensionally I have something to put into my theory now. My no wiggle theorem is mended by this, but somehow I have to translate that smooth behavior into the extremely discontinuous and peculiar behavior that we've seen over there. So now, graphical mathematics. Let's do this with the clicker. So what I want you to consider is a system. So two systems first. One, both at this concentration here. One has frictionless contacts, one has frictional contacts. They have different viscosities because they are different points on these curves. So the point on this curve is the slope on that curve. So I have some smooth progression from one to the other, and you can easily see what this means. It means I can draw basically a pair of lines here. I have this characteristic stress, so say the 25% and 75%, or you know, the last percentile and the first or whatever. I draw two lines across here, and I have essentially the following construction. For stresses below the yellow line, I'm on the lower curve. Then there's some smooth evolution, which takes me onto the upper curve. So this is a system which at low stress has the frictionless contacts here, high stress it's switched over to there. So what I'm now going to do is march the concentration here gradually to the right and see what happens. So as I move to the right, so increase the concentration a little bit, the first thing that happens is that this frictionless branch here is nowhere near its divergence point, so this slope hardly changes at all. The upper branch, which is the frictional behavior, moves up quite steeply. So you see I'm getting, but still these points are telling me I'm up here, I'm down there, and I smoothly connect. I'm now just going to go on, and you watch what happens. So under this scenario, you cannot avoid generating exactly the family of curves that I was looking for. So let me just go back through that. So it's because there's a characteristic stress scale, which takes me from the upper to the lower curve, that if, as I approach this first jamming point here, the upper slope is diverging, then it's inevitable for that magenta dot there to, at some stage, move to the left of the yellow dot. This is a kind of topological necessity. So without having any complicated theory of what this F curve looks like, the fact that I have stress-dependent friction does generate exactly the family of flow curves that explains the phenomenology of discontinuous shear thickening in these very dense suspensions, which is this family that I showed you before. And of course, those negative pieces are unstable, et cetera, et cetera. So you can go some way to checking this picture computationally. So this on the right is a computer simulation which actually measures this fraction F with a specific model for how the separation between particles does depend on the forces between them. But the important thing about this is that the evolution of those curves through these S shapes is happening for any reasonable function. because of the argument I was just giving you. So, as I was sort of saying before, I quite like this because this is real theoretical physics, but I don't need equations to convince you, or at least not to convince myself. And just to show that there's some real physics in what I've just told you, a perfectly plausible alternative sounding theory would be to say, well, okay, that's fine, but let's say that the friction depends not on the stress, but on the rate of strain. And this theory doesn't work at all. Because if I have instead of drawing these lines horizontal, if I draw them vertical, then it's true that as the slope of the blue curve goes higher and higher, this gets steeper and steeper. At no point can this ever pass to the left of the yellow. So there's, you know, proper physics in here too. Okay. So let me try to now say a little bit about how this kind of, if you see this as a mechanistic insight into the flow of very dense suspensions, which is what we do see, there's two things you can do with it. One is you can start doing significantly more mathematical and elaborate theory than I've shown you. And that is work in progress. It's surprisingly difficult, but I'm sure that in the next few years we'll make a significant headway with that, because I think we've seen, you know, the key thing that needs to go into the complete theory. The complete theory has to be tensorial. It has to deal with time-dependent flows, which I haven't talked about at all, et cetera, et cetera. But I think we are now just, for the first time, pointing in the right direction for a much more comprehensive theory. But meanwhile, even just knowing what I've told you, then this has already got its uses. And this is because these very dense suspensions, not just in lecture demonstrations like mine, but they occur in all kinds of technologies. So the key insight then is that if we have this behavior, the wiggles here, so all of the instabilities and so on are connected with the fact that these two jamming points are well separated, 58%, 64%. And 64%, though, is for, if you like, rough particles. It's for particles which, once they're fully in contact, have an arbitrarily large coefficient of friction. So a strategy I can do is to say, well, okay, well, it's now that my flow behavior is actually controlled by the microscopic physics of contacts, totally contrary to what the theories in the field were assuming for 50 years prior. So this separation here depends on what I have at my contacts. And in particular, if I go to these colloidal, or the particles in the suspension, and I coat them with some very slippery molecule, some Teflon-like molecule, then I can reduce that friction. So the idea then is you now have a dial to turn in a kind of contact engineering, which essentially can drive this set of behaviors, which is fascinating but may contain lots of things you don't want happening in your factory, back to something completely normal. So just to show that, same thing. But if basically it's the rough point, which is now being pushed to higher and higher. So this is for frictional particles. If I put slippery molecules at the contacts, I can just reduce this separation, because if I have, you know, something sufficiently slippery, then very few of the contacts will be unable to slide. So by the time I've done that, I've just gone back all the way to the standard model of Newtonian flow curves with a variable slope. So here's an example of something that you might see in a factory, though this is actually in the lab. This is melted chocolate. So if you're processing chocolate, the chocolate is melted. That doesn't mean it's all melted. Let me say exactly what's in chocolate in a second, but let's just show that movie again. So if you look at the surface over here, you see these striations, and also you see this is kind of juddering. So this is actually right on the edge of that behavior. And there's a reason for that. And that is because when you make chocolate, here's chocolate in its melted state, the cocoa butter is in yellow there, is melted, and that's the solvent. And everything else is solid. So there's sugar grains in there. This is done at about 40 degrees. It's like when you do it in a bain-marie. There's sugar grains, there's cocoa solids, there's milk powder if it's milk chocolate. And for all kinds of reasons, the solid fraction is as high as you can possibly make it, partly because all of those other things are less bad for you than the fat, but only slightly, frankly. Fat for sugar? Well, okay. Nonetheless, if you look at a chocolate recipe, you find that there's something in it which is lecithin, and often something called PGPR, which is a bigger molecule, which does exactly this job. So not unbeknown to science, there's a lot of science in chocolate, but this has been sort of known in this small domain for many years. So that's, I particularly like the way that in the USA, but definitely not in the European Union, you can get away with ingredients, chocolate, 100%. So you don't know what's the proportion of sugar, fat, and cocoa mass in Europe. You do know, and you can see. So anyway, but you see that there are these emulsifiers. Now, an emulsifier is a technical term, and emulsification is not what I've talked about. That this word should be replaced by contact friction modifiers. So that is actually a new understanding in the domain of chocolate making. But the point is that type of structure, mixture of various particles, obviously not generally spherical, that's a theorist's exaggeration, is present in lots of other materials. It's present in setting cement pastes, which are precursors for ceramics, so clay-like materials. So before you bake the tiles on the space shuttle, they are made of a fluid or paste, which is very like this. All kinds of things, wellbore fluids, and increasingly in energy materials as well. So when you're processing any of these kind of soft composite materials, it often is a target to get as much solid content in there as you possibly can whilst remaining processable. And so what this theoretical insight is telling you is that if you want to do that, you have to think about the detailed physics of the contacts and try to turn down the friction by whatever means is available to you. Okay, so I've come to the end of my story. This is the same as my initial slide. And thank you for your attention.
Thank you. Very good. So we'll open the floor to questions, both online and right here at the microphone. And Aiden, you're on. Just one, maybe two.
So you mentioned how the liquid crystals are shaped like needles. How do they behave? Because the needle shape would cause more block ups because they sort of would lock into, would go like block, would block each other much more often.
So that's a very good question. So there are two different kinds of liquid crystal. The ones that you have in your phone and laptop display, these are actually, they're rod-like molecules. And because they're so small, actually there's basically no friction between those molecules. So the liquid crystals which are used in displays are, they tend to make these swarms of aligned rod-like molecules, and then with an electric field, actually this is all on the blackboard behind me, with an electric field, you can turn them one way or turn them the other way, and that's what happens in a liquid crystal display. But you can make and find in nature systems which are like this, where you have quite big particles, which are rod-like, and then you can see the jamming effect at a much lower concentration. So it's like the log jam on the river that I showed you. You can get a tangled network of jammed sticks at a much lower concentration than you need to go to get a locked packing of spheres.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Very good. Thank you, Aiden. I have a question about what drew you to fluid dynamics.
Yeah, this is interesting. Well, so I was aware of this behavior from about the age of 10. And I don't think I saw it at a science fair or in a school's lecture. I think I saw it in my kitchen. So it was kind of the back of my mind for a long time. But I would be a sad person if I admitted that I'd spent 45 years trying to understand precisely this phenomenon. But it's possible that that was among things that drove me in that direction about sort of PhD time. So at that time, there was a guy called Sam Edwards in Cambridge, who has died last year, unfortunately. But he had this confidence that, you know, real theoretical physics, again, of the kind you see on the blackboard, which apparently is also by me, could be used by, in his case, it was this problem of entanglement in polymers. And so that's what I did my PhD on, and that got me hooked.
Oh, fantastic. Let's take the question in the house.
Yeah, hello. Your lecture reminded me of something, a technique I used 40 years ago in die sinking. And the way that worked was to sink a positive model into a block of steel under an enormous amount of pressure.
Right.
And lo and behold, after about 3 months in this press, a die sinking press or coining press, it yielded actually to the positive and impressed into that block of steel. I think it was somewhere between half and an inch deep. That would rather be the reverse of what you lectured on tonight. What is the... what is involved here?
So you're talking about then something which is baseline solid that can liquefy if I abuse it or subject it to extremely high conditions. So, okay, so that's something that we also have a bit of experience working on, but mainly in the case where the solid is amorphous. So if you ask me that question about a glass as the solid, I could give you a fuller answer. But for the point of view of the mechanics of steels and the like, there, because you have a crystal lattice, the ability of that to slowly adapt its shape when you're, say, forcing this other object into it, is to do with the plastic flow, which involves understanding the nature of the dislocations in the crystal lattice and how those gradually migrate to allow it to flow from one shape to another. So it's obviously a related problem. As you say, it's the kind of inverse problem, but because the starting solid material is crystalline, the actual mechanism for how that flow is able to arise is somewhat different from the kinds of thing that happens in these suspension systems where the basic structure is always disordered.
Very good. Here we have a question from the online audience. Have the ideas that you've explained here tonight been put to use to prevent disasters like landslides?
Well, that would be rapid progress. since the work that I described was published only in 2014. So the answer is no. And it's an interesting question, though, is you know, how much more would we need to understand to be able to get to grips with that? Now, again, landslides, again, is one of these reverse problems. It's where you have something which is a solid, and it may be a rather tenuous solid. So wet soil is a solid in a rather miraculous way. It's because, you've got quite a lot of fluid there. You may have air as well, you have particles which in this case tend to be adhesive. So the landslip I showed you, which again is, you know, the complement of this problem, is one where you have contacts between particles which are sticky, and then under some state of stress or flow, somehow there's a feedback which breaks all these contacts up. So that's a problem we're also interested in, but it's a sister problem to the one that I talked about.
Thank you. Question inside.
Yes, thank you for a great lecture. I'm wondering about nano possibilities for, say, surfactants with nanotechnology to change the flow patterns of these. Has that been something they've been looking into?
Well, so there's two avenues there. One is to think about the flow behavior of systems where the particles are really small. And as you get down towards a molecular scale, what happens is that you have more and more Brownian motion on the scale of your particles, so that they are thermally whizzing around. And that means that actually this idea of a sort of fixed mechanical contact becomes washed out, if you like, in this Brownian motion. So if you shrink the particles in this system down to this, the scale for Brownian motion being important is a couple of hundred nanometers. If you go down to 10 nanometers, it's dominant. And then you can also get this type of behavior, but the mechanism is somewhat different. And it's to do with overcoming the fact that you have a jammed phase, which is not a mechanical jam, it's more like a glass. It's got particles that in principle can move, but each is in a cage created by its neighbors. So then the solid phase is an amorphous but highly dynamic solid, in which the important thing is that the particles can't swap places. And then if you come with a stress, you can melt that. But there are also systems, we think, where you can make it go through the glass transition in the other direction. In other words, it will be the Brownian motion will be impeded because of the stress you put on, essentially because you're making it anisotropic. So there is a sort of sliding scale from this right the way down to the nano regime. And of course, if you're starting to talk about the physics of contacts and engineering the contact friction, that's basically nanotribology is the field. So at that scale, you know, the molecular details matter.
That's why I was kind of wondering about nanoparticles that are acting as a surfactant onto the larger particles to adjust the slipperiness of.
Yes, so you could imagine them being like ball bearings, perhaps. And that's an interesting idea. There's been some speculation that micelles could play that role. In fact, you might think that micelles of lecithin could play that role. And we have no proof that that's not actually what the lecithin does in the chocolate system. We don't know. Yeah, so okay. It could be that.
Thank you.
Thank you. Let's take one more question from inside.
I would like to ask probably the least technical question ever asked at a Perimeter Institute lecture. We have come to these lectures for years and years, and usually they're of the nature of, don't try this at home. I'm really curious to know, and I know this is not a cooking show, but what would the recipe be for mixing starch and water to get that effect that you had there?
Well, that's a great question, and actually the answer is really easy. So what you do is you start with the starch. It's like the initial steps of making a white sauce. You start with the starch. You add water more or less drop by drop, just a little, a little, a little, and you get to this. And if you've added a little bit too much, you'll find that you can pour it a bit too easily and it doesn't have quite such a nice, I'm going to just do this again. You see a little bit came to the top there. So if you see something which doesn't do that, then you've added a bit too much water, so put a bit more cornstarch in. And that's really all there is to it. And I was doing this before, obviously, preparing this, and it did, on this scale, like 3 liters, it did take me 45 minutes to get it right. But in your kitchen with a smaller amount, you can do it in 5 minutes.
Thank you.
Fantastic. Thank you. Very good. Ladies and gentlemen, Dr. Michael Cates. Thank you very much. Thank you.